studying and working towards this day. It's been a little bit unusual because of COVID, so it's been a little bit of an alternative way to have confirmation, but we are going to have them affirm their baptisms today, which is wonderful. And it is also just a day to worship together, so welcome. Welcome here, and welcome here as well online. I am Pastor Amy Barsh-Odall, if I didn't say that already. I am Pastor Amy, and welcome to Salem Lutheran Church and School. This worship service is being recorded and will be available on Salem's YouTube channel later in the day. If you are watching the replay of today's worship service, I also say welcome. If you are a visitor, welcome to Salem. Please sign our guest book, which is out in the narthex in the entryway, or ask any of the ushers if you have questions today. Also, after worship, we are inviting you to a celebration of the confirmands, and we will have some cake outside. We will have you say congratulations to the confirmands. They have put together their confirmation boards, which are out on display in the narthex, so you can read about their Bible verses and about their favorite Bible characters and things like that. And then they will also be placing in the courtyard, they will be placing their Bible verses into the courtyard gardening area, so you can watch them do that as well. So I hope I don't impale myself on those while we're in worship today, but they will be using those today after worship. Let's see, I have just a couple of very quick announcements that I want to make. First of all, the Salem picnic is next Sunday right after worship, so please, please come for that. We're really excited about that, to have some more fellowship together. Salem seems to do food very well, so please come for that. All you need to do is show up, come to worship, come to eat together, and we'll have fun together. Our Salem visioning team continues to meet. We have information about that in the e-news this week, so you can read about that. In 2 weeks, on November 11th, I think it is, I'm forgetting, two Saturdays from now, New City Parish is going to be having a big fundraiser here at Salem. New City Parish is an organization that Salem has supported in the past. I think they're celebrating their 30th birthday. So if you're interested in coming to that, let me know. It is a fundraiser for New City Parish, and that's happening here. Finally, I just want to make a real quick announcement advertising the Advent Bible study. The Advent Bible study is one that I really want to encourage everyone to participate in. I'm going to be offering it on Thursdays at 11 o'clock with my dad. My dad will also be teaching it with me from Minnesota, so it's on Zoom. We'll also be doing it at 7 o'clock on Zoom, and then I will try to see if there's interest on having it after worship on Sundays as well. It's called Light of the World, and I just think it's a great time, if you have not been doing Bible study, to let's participate together in a Bible study for Advent. It is 4 weeks long, and it's a really good one, called Light of the World. Okay, I think I've gotten that all done as quickly as I could. I'm a fast talker, I know, so sorry about that, but it is what it is. Let's begin with Allie Smizer. She's going to come on up and tell us about what happens today. It's another big day. It's the beginning of our generosity campaign. So she's going to read a little bit to us, and then we'll start worship.
It's just like 2019 again. It's got my rolling in a little late, so sorry. good morning, everyone. I'm so glad to see everyone. We have some visitors, so welcome. We're so happy to have you. My name is Allie Smizer, and I am the generosity steward here at Salem. And today we're beginning our annual generosity campaign. And what that means for us is that we're invited to prayerfully consider how we're going to share our financial gifts with God. And so we've sort of moved forward technologically. And we have an online pledge card that I would encourage all of you to complete. It's really important for you to take this time to consider and make a deliberate decision on how you're going to share your financial gifts with God. So we'll be talking about that more over the next 4 weeks. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the series that we have coming up. Today we're beginning a 4 week worship series based on generosity. It's specifically called Our Money Story. We all have a money story, whether we recognize it or not. Perhaps we are living from a story of fear or shame, or a story that, sorry, I printed that out so small, or a story that the church is dying and no longer relevant, or a story that our actions won't have an impact, or a story that we don't have enough.
Where might God be speaking a new narrative into the limited ones that we have told ourselves? This theme invites us to discover and tell money stories in light of God's money story of liberation and justice. This series encourages us to transform our generosity practices into more full expressions of who we are and what we believe. The theme is intentionally direct. It invites us to name exactly what we are talking about and not skirt around it. To speak of money is to invite tension into the room. We quickly want to avoid it. It's uncomfortable for us. But it's time we reframe this. Money and possessions are one of the most common topics in scripture, and Jesus talked about money more than faith and prayer. Our money story is a spiritual story. Thinking about God's money story should be liberating, inviting, and transforming. This generosity season, we invite you to remember, release, remain, and restore your money stories so that we can write the one that God is begging us to live into. Today's theme concept is remember. Thank you so much. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. I'll be around.
Our theme for today is remember, which is very fitting with our affirmation of baptism today as well, and with Reformation Sunday today. We remember Reformation. Let's stand as we begin worship. Here at Salem, we believe there is no person or created thing outside the active love and grace of God made known to us in the person of Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. May we remember that God created. May we remember that God liberated. May we remember that God fed. May we remember that God is still creating. God is still liberating. And God is still feeding us. Let this be our story. Let this be where we begin. Let us worship our holy God. We begin by singing, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God."
Thank you.
story of God calls us to remember that creation was made good and Sabbath is necessary. The story of God calls us to remember that we belong to one another, for we are bone of bone and flesh of flesh. The story of God calls us to remember that reconciliation between siblings is holy and slavery of any kind is evil. The story of God calls us to remember that the wilderness is real and that God will be with us, raining down manna and speaking in a still, small voice. The story of God calls us to remember that love looks like healing the sick, eating with the outcast, making room for the children, and seeing the unseen. The story of God calls us to remember, because if we forget, we risk making God's love and reconciliation small. So as we remember, may we declare, we believe in a God who made all things good, who stands with the suffering, walks with us in the wilderness, sees the overlooked, loves with an untamed heart, and makes room for all at God's table. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of our first lesson.
A reading from Exodus. On the 15th day of the second month after they had left Egypt, the whole company of Israel moved on from Elam to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai. The whole company of Israel complained against Moses and Aaron there in the wilderness. The Israelites said, "Why didn't God let us die in comfort in Egypt, where we had lamb stew and all the bread we could eat? You've brought us out into this wilderness to starve us to death, the whole company of Israel." God said to Moses, "I'm going to rain bread down from the skies for you. The people will go out and gather each day's ration. I'm going to test them to see if they'll live according to my teaching or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they have gathered, it will turn out to be twice as much as their daily ration." Moses and Aaron told the people of Israel, "This evening you will know that it is God who brought you out of Egypt, and in the morning you will see the glory of God. Yes, he's listened to your complaints against him. You haven't been complaining against us, you know, but against God." Moses said, "Since it will be God who gives you meat for your meal in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, it's God who will have listened to your complaints against him. Who are we in all this? You haven't been complaining to us, you've been complaining to God." Moses instructed Aaron, "Let the whole company of Israel come near to God. He's heard your complaints." When Aaron gave out the instructions to the whole company of Israel, they turned to face the wilderness. And there it was, the glory of God visible in the cloud. God spoke to Moses, "I've listened to the complaints of the Israelites. Now tell them, at dusk you will eat meat, and at dawn you'll eat your fill of bread, and you'll realize that I am God, your God." That evening, quail flew in and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew all over the camp. When the layer of dew had lifted, there on the wilderness ground was a fine, flaky something, fine as frost on the ground. The Israelites took one look and said to one another, "Manhu, what is it?" They had no idea what it was. So Moses told them, "It's the bread God has given you to eat. And these are God's instructions. Gather enough for each person, about 2 quarts per person. Gather enough for everyone in your tent." The people of Israel went to work and started gathering, some more, some less. But when they measured out what they had gathered, those who gathered more had no extra, and those who gathered less weren't short. Each person had gathered as much as was needed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Got a children's sermon. If I could have any kids come forward, that'd be awesome. Come on up. All right, I'm going to get my chair here. Got a couple kids. Come on up. You guys can sit down on the floor. I'm going to sit on my chair. All right, today we're talking about remembering, okay? We're talking about remembering. And soon our confirmation kids are going to come up and they're going to remember their baptism and they're going to make some promises that they will make for themselves, okay? Now, one promise they will is that they will be generous with their time, their talents, and their money or their treasures, okay? So God wants us to share. That's what we learned about today. God wants us to share. I bet your parents want you to share, right? You've heard that before, to share, so that everyone has enough. Now, we just heard this Bible story about some grumpy people. They were grumpy because they didn't think they were going to have enough food, okay? There was a time about 2.5 years ago that we have a really good example of this in our own country. Do you remember what some people were doing because they didn't think they would have enough? They were buying all the toilet paper. Do you remember that? They were buying all the toilet paper, and they were buying all the spaghetti noodles, and they were buying all the hand sanitizer. So not everybody had some, right? Some people had a whole bunch, and other people didn't have enough. And it was getting a little scary because maybe if you don't have hand sanitizer, you can wash your hands with soap. But if you don't have toilet paper, that's a big problem, right? Yeah, because we aren't campers. We don't usually go camping and know how to do things without toilet paper, right? So that's a really good example of how God wants us to share, okay? God wants us to share our toilet paper, and God wants us to share other things that we have. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about that, but in the Bible story, God made it so that everybody had enough, and that was a good thing. And so I think God does that to us today. God knows that we all have enough, and that we have enough that we can actually share too. Is that good news? Yeah, so if you have a little extra of something, you can share it with someone else. You can bless someone else with that. If you have a little extra time and you can help someone do something at home, maybe if your mom and dad ask you to empty the dishwasher, that would be sharing your time, right? If you have a talent, like maybe you know how to sing really well, you could share that with someone else by singing to them. And if maybe you got some money for your confirmation and you wanted to give a little to the church or to something else that would be helpful, that would be a way to share your money as well, right? Okay, we all get money for our birthdays and Christmas and things like that. We can give some of our money to help other people. Does that sound like a good idea? I get a lot of nods here. How about out here? Does that sound like a good idea? Yes, it does. All right, wonderful. So we don't have to be grumpy. We know that God gives us enough and that we have enough to share. All right, so we're going to see if the adults hear that message in a few minutes after I give my sermon too. Okay, you may go back to your seats. Thanks for coming up. Let's all stand for the reading of the gospel. The gospel reading for today is from St. Luke, the 22nd chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When the hour came, he took his place at the table and the apostles with him. He said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant promise in my blood. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. I knew I was going to trip on these things up here, so careful. All right, grace and peace to you from God our Father and his Son Jesus, who is the Christ. Today, I just lost my sermon. We'll see where it ended up. Here we go. All right. Today, we heard two scripture texts. The first was from the book of Exodus, the story of the Israelites where they were leaving slavery and they were in the wilderness and they were receiving manna. Okay, manna is a kind of a bread. The second story is the story of the Last Supper. Both stories are stories of remembrance. Both are stories that we can connect to our theme of generosity. When we think about our money stories, we often think about that rat race that we're in to get more and more, right? We always want more. We often view our money stories from a place of scarcity, that we don't have enough, that we need more. Well, in today's Old Testament reading, it begins with the Israelites being fearful that they will not have enough food. They are afraid that they're going to starve to death. But God maintains a relationship with God's people. And God provides a concept for what enough looks like. God allowed everyone to gather enough manna for each person. But anything extra was to be shared and not hoarded, okay? If you kept extra, your manna actually rotted. By doing this, God helped guide the Israelites into a mindset of not hoarding or being selfish. Instead, they gathered enough for what they needed, never more, and they shared among each other so that everyone always had enough. Is it working now? Oh, we're wonderful. Like I said before, if you didn't hear me, I have never preached so hot that I turned the fire alarm on before, but that's pretty cool. All right, so we're talking about enough, having enough, okay? So the story in the Old Testament, which has always been told from generation to generation, reminds us that we are called to live with enough. We don't need to hoard our stuff. We can share our abundance so that everyone can be satisfied. Think about how you can apply that to your own money story. Your understanding of how you keep, share, or hoard your money, okay? So think about that. Now the gospel lesson has two distinct messages about remembering and money. The first is that Judas monetized fear and corruption. The second is that Jesus shared a meal in which there was enough for everyone at the table and that everyone was invited to that table, even Judas. So Jesus takes what is necessary for living and he splits it up and he shares it with everyone, asking everyone to remember the act of sharing so that everyone has enough. Kind of getting the topic here? All right. So today we are starting a journey. It is a 4-week journey of looking at our own personal money stories, how our generosity of money has been shaped and influenced by the practice of generosity in our scriptural stories, which we read from the Old Testament and the New Testament, and how our money stories have been shaped by our own personal lives. So in these two scripture texts, we remember God's steadfast relationship with us throughout our lives. God is always with us throughout everything in our lives. We remember that Judas betrayed Jesus in exchange for money, but he was still invited to the table. We remember that the Israelites complained, they were grumpy in the wilderness, but they were still given enough manna to eat by God. Even in stories of desperation and betrayal, we are given the gift of God's provision, of the feast of enough, and the holy meal of remembrance, which we will share together today. Today, may all of you remember, God's grace is overflowing. We live a life of abundance. And we have been called to share in generosity and to share generously. Let us pray. The peace that passes all understanding, keep our hearts and our minds on Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's stand for our next hymn. Thank you. At this time, we're going to begin our affirmation of baptism portion of the service today. I want you to note that there are three people who are here that are being confirmed. We also actually have someone who is on Zoom that is being confirmed as well. She moved to Iowa a few days before school started, and so we actually have four students that are being confirmed today, but we have, a vibrant community on Zoom as well. I think we have at least 40 people that are on Zoom today, and we have, 80 or 90 people here today, so we are all worshiping together. And so this is a new thing for us to have someone on Zoom, but we're going to try our best. Her name is Evelyn Bloyer, and she is now living in Iowa, in the great state of Iowa. So that's wonderful. I used to go to school in Iowa, so I like Iowa. All right, so Julian is going to read his confirmation reading first. Go ahead. This is Julian LaScala. You take your mask off when you read.
A reading from 2 Timothy. But the Lord stood at my side and gave me strength.
Each of the children picked out what their favorite Bible verse was. So that was Julian's, and now I'm going to read Evelyn's, or Evie as I call her. Hers is from Romans chapter 8. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Next we have Joshua Castaneda.
My confirmation verse is from the book of John, chapter 14, verse 27. The peace I leave with you, my peace I give you, I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid.
Thank you. And our final student is Miles Hall.
Romans 8:31. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?
Thank you. Now at this time, I'm going to ask the confirmands to come and stand facing Karen. I'm going to read the first part so you can go, yep, face right there. That's a good spot right there. Joshua, you're going to need your butt. You're going to need your book. Yep. Okay. So confirmation is a time to reaffirm our baptismal promises. It's a time to celebrate passage to young adulthood and to open ourselves to the stirring of the Holy Spirit within us. The affirmation of baptism recalls various stages along your faith journey. We celebrate the fact that you have been baptized, that you have heard God's word and shared in the Lord's Supper, and that the Spirit has been present and guiding your lives.
We brought you to Jesus Christ and his followers through baptism. Water was poured on you, a candle was lit for you, and the Holy Spirit came to live within you. You have been instructed in the scriptures. And you have been united with God and with God's people in Holy Communion. We encourage you now to reaffirm the baptismal promises and to open yourself to the stirring of the Holy Spirit within you through confirmation.
All right, now this is when you are going to follow me as we go from station to station. So you're going to come here to the font, okay? And I'm going to ask you a question. And Evie on Zoom, you're going to answer at home as well. Julian, Evie, Joshua, and Miles, through the waters of baptism, you were given new life and God made you his own. You say to me, I continue my faith walk. And now we come over here to the pulpit. Or to the Bible here. Julian, Evie, Joshua, and Miles, through the scriptures, God teaches us about God and shows us how to walk in faith as followers of Jesus Christ. Please say, I continue my faith walk. And now we come over here to the altar. All the way up, yep, there we go. Let's see. I can't see everybody. There we go. Okay. Julian, Evie on Zoom, Joshua, and Miles, through Holy Communion, we receive forgiveness and are renewed by God's unconditional love. And you respond, I continue my faith walk. I'll go over to the cross. Julian, Evie, Joshua, and Miles, by living and dying, Jesus gave us life and returned to the Father to send us the Holy Spirit. May God's Spirit guide your living. And you respond, I continue my faith walk.
I continue my faith walk.
Okay, now we're moving over here. We're getting our steps in today. Come on over here. And I'm going to stand here, and you're going to stand facing me. Let's see, I think. Actually, you're going to face outward, and I'm going to stand down here. That would be better. All right. Julian, Evie, Joshua, and Miles, you have come today to affirm your baptism and to make a public profession of your faith. You can smile too, okay? In accordance with our Lord's command, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. You have been instructed in the Word of God and led to a knowledge of His will and of His gracious gospel, and you now desire to make public profession of your faith. As you affirm your baptism, I ask you to reject sin, to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. After I ask you these three questions, I ask that you will respond, I do. Okay? Do you turn away from the devil and all the forces that defy God? Do you turn away from the powers of this world that rebel against God? Do you turn away from the ways of sin that draw you from God? If so, please say, I do. Okay. And now I'm gonna address you all and the congregation as well, okay? With the whole church, let us confess our faith. Do you believe in God the Father? Together we say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Julian, Evie, Joshua, and Miles, you have made public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God, and to share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? If so, please answer, and the words are on the screen, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. People of God, this is for everyone out here, do you promise to support these students and pray for them in their life in Christ? If so, please answer, we do, and we ask God to help and guide us. All right, at this time, I'm going to ask you to spread out. So Joshua, I'm going to have you stand over here. Julian, you're going to stand here. Miles, you're going to stand over here. And Evie, you're going to be standing at home. And I'm going to ask all family members to come forward. We're going to do a laying on of hands at this time.
You stand at home.
Anyone who wants to come up forward and support their student, please come forward, and you can put your hand on their head and put your hand on their shoulder. We'll wait for people to come forward. And this is something that I do individually, so I'm going to do this per student here. I'm going to maybe say the whole congregation is going to come up. Nobody's going to stay seated. All right. We're going to start with Julian. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Julian La Scala the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, giving him patience in suffering, and bringing him to everlasting life. Amen. And now at this time, I'm going to do something I've never done before, but I'm going to come to Evie, and I'm trying to, I guess I'll stand in front of the camera here. I think that she can see me here. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Evelyn Bloyer the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen.
Amen.
Now Joshua. Anybody touching hands? Everybody can touch something? Okay, there we go. All right. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Joshua Castaneda the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. Amen. Miles. Right. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Miles Hall the gift of your Holy Spirit, confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. Amen.
Amen.
Everyone stays where they're at. Today, Julian, Evie, Joshua, and Miles have promised to continue to walk in their faith. Please remember this is just one step on their journey. Your family has brought you this far. Now it is up to you to continue this faith journey. This is not a journey that you have to ever walk alone. We, as your faith community, everyone who is here in person or online or that wasn't able to come today, will continue to support you and to care for you, and you will and will be here as you need us. We hope that you will continue to find ways to connect with this community. And most importantly, we want you to continue to be connected to God. Let us rejoice with Julian, Evie, Joshua, and Miles, our sisters and brothers in Christ. Together we say on the screen, we rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world.
Amen.
Amen. This is a time to celebrate, so let's clap for our confirmands. All right. You may be seated. Thanks for coming up. Again, they will be outside and they will greet you after worship, so please say congratulations to them. I do have a certificate. Don't let me give certificates out and to give out our plaques to put in the courtyard. This is a big day. This is a big celebration for us. It is wonderful that we can share this with you. We continue to look forward to seeing you in worship, continue to look forward to seeing you volunteer at church and to participate in the life of the church. This is not a graduation ceremony. You notice that. It is not a graduation. It is a continuation of your faith journey. All right. At this moment in our worship service, we focus on our financial offering. It is offering time and our generosity. We ask that you give to support our ministry of spreading God's love in the world. Please use the Vanco Faith app on your phone. Go to our website, salemlutheranglendale.org. You may mail a check to the church office, or you may leave an offering in the offering plate in the narthex, the entryway, when you come in. So today, as we offer our gifts to you, we pray that you would recenter our narrative. We would remind us that we do not give out of shame or guilt. We do not give out of obligation. We do not give to feel worthy. We give because we want to. We give because we know that God gives us so much that we are able to share. Let's listen to Emily and Dr. J as they share their gift of music with us.
That saved a wretch like me.
Thank you. The dinner table is always a place where we tell stories. We tell stories of growing up and falling in love, of making mistakes and figuring it out. We tell stories that make us laugh, stories that make us cry, and stories that help us remember. This table here is no different. For at this table, we tell stories about a God who loves us unconditionally. We tell stories about a man who fed the hungry, washed the feet of the disciples, and said, "This is my body for you." So friends, as you come to this table today, bring your stories. Stories about who you are and who you want to be. Stories of shame and disappointment, stories of fear and faith. Bring your money stories, your faith stories, your love and heartbreak stories. Bring them all. For no matter the narrative, God welcomes all of us to this table. You belong here. There is a seat that is saved for you. If you are on Zoom right now, I ask you to please take your elements out and to hold them up. I will ask you to wait to consume the elements until Scott, who is running the Zoom, will give you instructions after the Lord's Prayer. So we're trying something different today, so please don't consume your elements until after the Lord's Prayer. If you are in person, there will be two stations. The ushers will dismiss you row by row. You will hold out your hands for the bread. If you want to request gluten-free wafer, you may do that as well. Then you will consume it. And then you will go to the person with the wine, and the outside ring is wine. The inside is grape juice. You may take either one, and you may consume it. Once you are done with the cup, you put it in the basket on either side of the stations here today. I'm giving very detailed instructions for now because we haven't had in-person communion for so long, and we keep trying to figure it out in those last couple of weeks as we've been rehabbing it again. So that's what we're going to try to do today, and then you will go back to your seats, all right? And the people who are on Zoom, once they have finished their communion, we will wait for us to re-begin again. So here we go. In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. He gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for everyone to drink. He said, "This cup is the new covenant, promise in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this to remember me." As we prepare to eat together as Jesus' disciples did, we remember and we speak that truth out loud, praying together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. At this time, we will have the distribution of communion. I ask the confirmants to come forward as they are serving communion with me.
Can those on Zoom hear me? If you take your elements now, I want to tell you that this is the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. And this is the blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. Amen. Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. Holy God, as we leave this table, help us to remember this moment. Help us remember that with you, all are invited. Help us remember that with you, there is a seat for everyone. Help us remember that with you, there is enough food to go around, that even Judas was invited to the meal, and that there is manna in the wilderness. Help us remember so that as we go, we can build tables like this in the world. We need more tables like this in the world. Gratefully we pray. Amen. Let us sing. Creator of all things, speaking reformation into being, Jesus Christ, Savior of the world, raising the dead, Holy Spirit, living voice, calling and enlightening the church, Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace, sound the good news. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Everyone have a great week. Thank you. Evie, congratulations.
Thank you, Scott. I ditto. Congratulations, Evie.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Have a good week. Thanks, Scott.